Welcome to Being and Becoming, Class 4 at Center for Spiritual Living, Asheville. It is February 2018, for those of you watching online. Maybe you're in like 2020, 2030, and you're watching this class online, but remember there is only the eternal now. So we are all here now. We always begin everything in treatment, so take a deep breath. I like to close my eyes, but that's just my way of letting go of things that distract me. And I like to breathe because my body is particularly grateful for a little oxygen. So as we take a deep breath, let it out. And with that, let go of any concerns or cares you may have. Let go of anything but this moment. This moment is perfect. It is whole. It is complete. Right here and right now. And so we open up to this greater idea that says there's only one thing going on. Doesn't matter what we call it, it is infinite, absolute, self-existent, it is creative mind. We open up to that idea that there is a oneness. And because everything is one, we are connected with that oneness. Not only are we connected with it, but we are made out of it. Not only are we made out of it, but it is manifest as us now. So we open up to this idea that we are spiritual beings living in a spiritual universe governed by spiritual law, that we are greater than we could ever imagine, that we are connected with everyone, everywhere, everything, and everywhen. And so I know that these amazing, powerful, spiritual beings listening to my voice right now get everything that they need out of this class. That the information in this class lifts them into greater consciousness, demonstrating better and better lives. And with great gratitude and thanksgiving for Fenwick Holmes, for Science of Mind, for Center for Spiritual Living, Asheville, for these amazing students, I simply release this into all that spirit is, because I know that spirit is all, as together we say,
and so it is.
Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. Sandy, right? I'm practicing. Hi, Donna. Hi, Steve. Suzanne.
Yes.
Got it. Okay. Welcome, welcome, welcome. So we are, if it gets hot in here for you, let me know. Did we crank the heat up?
Feels perfect.
Feels good.
It was preset at 70,
so it should be okay.
It was preset what?
At 70, so it should be okay.
Okay, so your reading last week was chapters 5 and 6.
Correct.
We talked about if thoughts are ideas, are they real? You remember that in your reading? We talked about talking horses. Well, we didn't talk about them, but the reading was about talking horses. So because I'm not going to put a lot of energy into that, it was a lot of pages about talking horses. I guess in their day, the idea that animals have intelligence and are able to communicate was novel. Do you know that dolphins have a language of their own? And that people can talk to dolphins in real sentences? And they can talk back. Mm-hmm. I have a friend who works at SeaWorld in Orlando. And his job is to talk to the dolphins, and he's been doing that for decades. So the idea that there were talking horses probably is novel in its time, but not real exciting to me. But I want to open it up before we just move on to see if there are any comments about that. Or if you have any thoughts about it. Have you ever had a dog that talked to you?
Oh my God.
Have you ever had a cat that talked to you?
Yes,
yes. So the idea that animals can communicate, even answer puzzles and figure things out. Like, I thought I locked that up. I thought I put that away, and you managed to get into it. Or, do you really understand English? Yes, the answer is yes. So intelligence is ubiquitous. It is everywhere and always present. And not only is it present in people, but remember we talked about it being present in plants? Wasn't that the first class of this class?
Yes.
Yeah, that you can put biofeedback machines up on plants and think a thought and they will react. So the idea that horses could tap out answers and then even, I mean, I don't know how far this went, but they say that they actually mouthed words. It starts to get a little suspect for them. But I think the point is that there's intelligence all around us that we're usually not aware of and not privy to. Any comments or thoughts on the idea that things are ideas? Do you understand the logic that they cannot not be real? Because if things were not real, they have the intelligence of the universe within them, and even though they appear not to exist until we notice them, which takes us into the quantum realm, that things exist in possibility and probability until they are observed, and then that which is observed collapses into form. If a tree falls in the forest, do you hear it? Does it make a sound? Evidently it does make a sound because there is that intelligence and presence of life that brings it into form and sustains it whether anyone is looking at it or not. Now I'm a firm believer that in my life, you don't exist until I see you. And whatever you are to me is me reflecting on you. So that if someone appears to be cranky, that's me reflecting on them. Otherwise, I wouldn't notice it. Otherwise, I would have a wonderful experience with them. And usually, if I judge someone to be cranky, I have engaged and hooked. And then the dance goes on. But someone else may be right next to me and not have an experience of crankiness at all. And so their experience of, and remember I said that was exactly my first husband, that his second wife had a different man that she was married to than I did, but I have to take total responsibility for that, that was my projections onto him of his personality, and that when he got with someone else who didn't see him that way, he didn't have that personality. It was a mind blower to me that someone could change so radically, and then I learned that it was all me, that I bring that out of people, or at least I brought that out of him, and that I bring my experience out of everyone in my world. So I don't want to discount this idea that everything in your world you are creating, it is there by right of consciousness, and your observing of it manifests it. But he's saying there's a level of reality that goes beyond that. He uses the idea of the rose, because if I see a rose, that's my rose. But if you see a rose, there's still that rose. And it's in the exact same place. And Ernest talks about that in the textbook. He says that only because we are one can we see the same things and can we even communicate and be understood. If we were some kind of a different alien species that didn't have anything to do with people or something like that, if one of us was like, who knows what may be hanging out in this room, that we wouldn't be able to see each other, we wouldn't be able to communicate to each other. So he's saying the very fact that we can see each other and have and relate to each other and talk to each other is a demonstration of the oneness. And Fenwick is pushing on that same thing, saying that things are, and this goes to the whole burgeoning New Thought movement that was saying everything is an illusion. Everything is an illusion. It's not really real. And I used that, and he picked it apart and said, that's crazy-making stuff. Things are real at the level that we perceive them to be real. So if my gas gauge is going down, and I'm perceiving that to go down, I need to go and get gas. Unless I have a really clear consciousness that I can drive forever on no gas, then I need to address the certain fundamental realities of life. Does that make sense?
Yes.
That was the point he was making. Do you have any other questions or comments about the reading this week?
So that's why my friends are so awesome.
Because of you, you bet. You bet, Amanda. Nicholas.
I noticed in the reading that it says that our attitude determines the way another person shows up, what develops in the, say, the dance between two people is determined by one's personal attitude.
Right, haven't you noticed that to be true?
Yes.
Wow, it's so apparent with children that if you look at a kid and you say, you're the problem child, you're the problem, you're the scapegoat, you know, usually it's the fourth child in the series that becomes the, or actually I think it's the third one that becomes the scapegoat, that if you tell a child they're a scapegoat, they become a scapegoat. If you tell them they're a problem, they become the problem. If you tell them that they're dumb, they become dumb. If you tell them that they're smart, they become smart. That's what we do in our kids' club. If you tell them that they're magnificent, they become magnificent. That they're powerful, they become powerful. If you tell them all these great things and you really believe that, then that's what that child becomes. You pull it right out of them. So yes, we have relationships which reflect our attitude. That's why one person can live in a world where everybody is a crook, everybody is a liar, everybody is a cheat, and somebody else can live in that same world. Everybody is wonderful, everybody is kind, everybody is generous, everybody is supportive. It's because we bring ourselves to every relationship that we have. So check yourself out. What kind of a world do you live in? All you're doing is looking in a mirror. And it's very empowering to me to be able to have that, because then I'm the one who can change how I see people and how I pull right from them. That's why you guys are so fantastic, because I pull that right out of you. I pull your magnificence out, your brilliance out. I'm just gathering it all up to have the best class ever, the best center ever, because we pull that out of you. And my guess is you're in other situations and that doesn't get pulled out. I mean, we just had the holidays.
That also works. I used to teach at UNCA, and I took students who, and I didn't want honors students or anything. I just like run of the mill, you know, engineers. And I was thrilled with their teaching, with their writing.
Good.
Yeah, and they wrote, and you know, they won all sorts of prizes and things like that.
Because you were thrilled with them.
Yeah.
So run-of-the-mill engineers, that's why you said engineers, because you were teaching writing. Yeah. So you wanted engineers, and you brought the writer out of them. Well, you must really be liking the poetic descriptives that Fenwick gives us.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anything else? Kristen, who's about to leave to go to California and go to ministerial school on Friday. Yes.
You can see that at the restaurant really well with the servers. We'll have, like, I can get all amazing tables who all tip, you know, 20 to 50% all night, and then somebody else gets stiffed all night every table.
Right.
And it's all what you're pulling to you.
When my son was in high school, he was 15, he got a job at Sears at the mall. And he had been raised in this stuff, although now he's like, you know. But he was 15, he was working at Sears, and he would just hang out. He'd just lean up against the wall, he would let customers come and go, and then all of a sudden he would go up and talk to somebody, and they would buy a table saw, or they would buy a generator, they would buy something really big. And the other people, because here's this kid, you know, who just shows up after school and makes the big sales, the other people who have been there for years and years and are working all day and selling a screwdriver, you know, for an hour of their time, that kind of thing, were annoyed with him. And he would laugh and say, the only people I talk to are the ones who are going to buy. So there was something within him that knew in advance who the buyers were and who the talkers were and the shoppers were. And he would pick up on the buyers and walk up and talk to them, and they would buy something big. So yes, you got that, Kristen. You make big tips while someone else doesn't. Now, what do you think the attitude difference is with the non-big tip receiver?
Victim.
Victim, yes, what else?
They believe that people are bad tippers.
They believe that people are bad tippers. They believe that people are cheap. They believe that people don't have money, that they don't have money, that the universe is limited in money. And so they don't get the tips. So that's true for money, that's true for love, that's true for friendship or kindness. Karen?
They also don't think that there's a direct correlation of how they treat the people and how what comes back.
Oh, yeah, because if you disdain someone, you know, and you can't tell by how people dress. You can't tell by how they look as to what's going to happen. So if you go up with an attitude and you're all better than they are and disdaining of them, you're not going to pull out the generous tipper in them. But Kristen could get the same person and be all bubbly and loving and supportive and you know, go the extra mile and take care of them, and then she gets a 50% tip. Same person, the difference is us.
I can even see it within myself. Like if I'm having a bad day and I go to work, then I'll get like if I get a couple bad tips in a row, I'm like, oh, wait a second, and I'll go to the bathroom and like
clean
take
it up.
A minute and regroup.
Yes.
And then I'll make good tips for the rest
good.
Of the day.
Good
so.
For you to have the awareness to realize that everything going down the toilet is you, and to stop it and turn it around. It's not that we never have things go awry. It's that we stop it, second thought. You're not stuck with what you thought a minute ago. You can go to the bathroom, do some breathing, clean it up, get your head screwed on straight, and go out and have the best night ever. Excellent, excellent. Any other questions or comments? We have good stuff tonight. So I am on chapter 7 and 8. Are you enjoying kind of having a preview before you get to the reading?
Yes.
And don't you feel really smart when you read it? That's the point. That's the point. Chapter 7, the part I play in cosmic mind. Now, there are three things that I want to talk to you about that I'm not completely in agreement with. And keep in mind that this was a long, long time ago. We're almost around to the 100-year mark for this. And we were still figuring out how metaphysics really works. So he says that we are not all of God, though all that we are is God. And this was a common thing even 40 years ago when I was starting in this teaching. They would say, oh, well, we're just a part of God, just a little part of God. Don't ask so much of me. I'm just a little part of God. I'm just a little tiny, tiny thing. No. In order for a unity to exist, it must exist in its totality at every point simultaneously. You got that yesterday with John's talk of how big is your God. In order for this to exist, it must exist completely at the point of you, all of it, and you, all of it at the same time. It doesn't bounce from Sandra to Michelle and back. You don't have, okay, this is my 5 minutes of sun, you know, of light, of clarity, of God being me. No, no, all the time. Spirit must exist in its totality as you in order for this to be real at all. So no idea of I'm just a little part of Spirit is. Now, I'll give you that we can't fathom it. We cannot wrap our head around that at all because our heads are focused in time and space. So maybe we can look out at the Hubble spaceship, the Hubble telescope space photos. We can look at those and really stretch out. But then you get to this thing where, well, what about even beyond this universe layer? There are simultaneous universe layers happening all at once right now. Oh my gosh, I can't wrap my head around that. I actually think there are people in mental institutions that got a glimpse and they couldn't handle it. And it just literally fried them. So all that spirit is at the point of us right now. So think about it. What do you need to create? Sell your business? Heal your back? Create something magnificent? Spirit's got it. It's okay. There's plenty of power, of creative force, of unformed substance to manifest whatever it is you choose to have in your life. The sun is coming up tomorrow. the planets are all holding together, space and gravity and light is all doing its thing. You're good with whatever you want to create. That's the value of that idea, that there is no limit to what part of it is yours, because as soon as you have a part, you have limited it. So there's no part. Do you get that? I did not want you led astray by Fenwick. Well, Barbara says that it's the whole thing, but Fenwick, whew, Fenwick says it's just a part. No. And had Fenwick lived, you know, another 100 years, I'm sure he would have come on board with all of quantum physics and math and science and all of that.
Do you think that changed because of more knowledge of science has proved these things? That
sure.
People accept it as
Well, people don't accept it as norm. You are the unique ones. Come on, everybody thinks we're nuts. Not only that we are God, but that we are all of God. And yet, quantum physics proves that beyond a shadow of a doubt. It's easier to say and to sell a book that says all that you are is God. But you are not all of God. That's crazy. That's what Ernest says in the textbook. He said, that's crazy. That's nuts to say you're all of God. And yet, either we're all of God or we're not. So did people change, those of us who have changed? Yeah. The breakthroughs in science have really helped with that. Because then it's not a religious tenet, it's science, it's math. But let's not be naive. Most of the world does not believe like we do. Most of the world does not believe that there is a power and a presence within us that is infinite, that we can use to create heaven on earth in whatever way we choose. Most of the world feels separated and victimized. And then if you throw some kind of religion on top of that, then it's an anthropomorphic deity who is just in particular out to get that person, that culture, that race, whatever it is. So, hats off to you. He also talks about any Troward students? No, okay. He also starts out by saying the farthest advance of God into self-expression is in each of us. That whatever spirit has advanced the farthest that it can go as us. And I have to chuckle and go, you know, can you imagine the people in the spaceship out there watching us laughing? A week ago they threatened to blow each other up with nuclear bombs, and they think they're the most advanced consciousness in the universe and beyond. How absurd. But it goes back to what I thought was Troward, because he puts it in the Edinburgh Lectures on Mental Science, but Troward, I find out, took it from a guy named Arthur Young. And what he talks about is God sleeps in the mineral, awakens in plants, walks in animals, and thinks in man. And that's a lovely idea, but I don't think God's asleep in the minerals. I don't think God is ever asleep. I don't think that infinite intelligence and consciousness can be asleep. That's why we don't call the subjective the unconscious, because you're never unconscious. Awareness can never be unconscious. So whatever the intelligence and wisdom of the universe that manifests itself in and as all things, I don't think it's asleep. And I don't think there is a hierarchy of evolution and consciousness equating. I think that's a way for us to say we are just the most advanced so that we can do whatever we want to the animals and the plants and the minerals, because we are the pinnacle of the manifestation of spirit. Now, I think maybe we are the pinnacle of the manifestation of spirit, but not necessarily that we are the highest developed. I think everything, even this plastic table, is the pinnacle of the manifestation of spirit, because spirit is infinite, so you cannot have a place where it stops peaking. There's no relationship in spirit. That's why we call it absolute instead of relative, no hierarchy. And anybody who's ever held a rock long enough know that that rock is alive. It is absolutely alive, the same way the plastic in the table is alive. And all we have to do is open up our awareness to the aliveness that permeates, penetrates, and fills all things and all space. So I didn't want you to get sucked into that, because what a great ego boost that is. We are the furthest advance of spirit. No, I'm sure spirit has advanced farther in other dimensions and other realms and other life forms. I just can't believe that we are it.
Let's hope not.
Really.
Where does he put angels then?
He doesn't put angels.
Okay.
Where would you put angels?
Above us.
Above us?
Yes. More evolved. Huh? Helpers.
Maybe. They're certainly not as focused into form as us.
Oh, yeah.
And he talks about a thought manifests into form as it becomes a slower vibration. That this thought of this table is simply a high vibration thought slowed down to manifest as form. And our bodies are the same way. So yeah, I think that the room is full of angels and I can't see them. So my guess is that they're vibrating at a higher level. Yeah, great. So his rationale to that idea is that God could not. Now, I'm always cautious when I hear the phrase that God cannot. It doesn't make any sense. And an infinite, absolute, self-existent cause, you don't have any room for cannot. But his thought process is God could not have the delightful experiences we have as individuals without us. Okay, I can get that. That spirit is manifesting in and as us, and that is why we are here. Edwin Gaines says, why are we here? We're here to let spirit have a bigger party. That spirit could not know how to love. Now, if love is all there is, how in the world could spirit not know how to love without us? You know, the human race could disappear, and I believe that spirit would still love, that spirit would have delightful experiences, that spirit would enjoy certain things. But it's, again, an ego boost to say spirit as the pinnacle of the advance of spirit that I am allowing spirit to experience something that it could not experience without me. Be careful with that one. I do like the idea that because we are here, spirit would not be complete without us. Because if I'm here and then I'm gone, there's that whole. And then the infinite is no longer infinite. It's the infinite and the whole. And then all of time and space falls apart. Because you cannot have an infinite without something. That's why I'm hesitant to have anything that says God could not or spirit could not. I think that spirit would find a way. You know, just really do.
What about the concept of spirit experiences something through you, but if it didn't have you to experience it through, it wouldn't have that experience.
It wouldn't have that experience, but not that it couldn't. Believe me, spirit would find another person to experience it through.
Oh, but I'm just saying each individual is unique in what they experience and how they see things and stuff like that. So they'd never find another one that's the same as you or anybody else.
But to say that spirit could not have that experience.
Yeah.
I believe that spirit can, and then you fill in the blank. Spirit can anything, but doesn't it make you feel good? Doesn't it make you feel warm and fuzzy to know that you are allowing the infinite creation of the universe to expand by means of you into greater levels of experience, and just awakening in the morning and looking around, you've somehow enlarged that infinite expansion.
It makes me think like a playwright, a director needs the actors on the stage to actually play out the play. And spirit needs us to actually feel the delight or
and I'm
feel
just
the
hesitant
language.
To use that word need, because you know any good director
right.
would get another actor if
oh,
one,
yes.
if one
if
could
it wasn't
cancel.
Working.
Pardon me?
If it wasn't working.
If it wasn't working, yes. So be careful of the cannot and the need, because Fenwick throws them around pretty generously. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
I don't you want you looking at spirit as limited in any way, because then we've lost the whole absolute infinite thing. And once we lose that, then we are no longer one. We're just this separate person on planet Earth hoping that we don't get screwed over by our concept of deity. I don't want to go there. Okay. So then he moves on into what I think is more rational thought. And he talks about the self, because the name of the chapter is The Part I Play in Cosmic Mind. So he's talking about the self, and he says that the self, which is us, rests on a common unit underlying the absolute self. So we're going to give you different ways to look at it, so don't freak out about the languaging yet. There is a common unit that we rest on, he says. Emerson said, there is one soul common to all men. And so he's saying that there is a common unit that the self rests on. He's trying to bring up this idea of oneness. We are within an all-comprehensive self. Emerson's essay on the oversoul. There is an oversoul that all of our souls are a part of. There is one soul common to all. The self rests upon a common unit, and we are within an all-comprehensive self. Like, we are within this greater self of spirit. Does that make sense?
Yes.
I don't want to see any deer in the headlight, because I'm only going to lose you from here.
If that's the case.
There is a unity that gives our love an all-embracing charity.
Embracing what?
Charity.
Charity?
Charity. Compassion. Okay. Kindness. Okay. So there is a oneness that we all rest in. There is a soul that includes all of us on a soul level. And I've never really been comfortable with this idea of soul. It's kind of like the intermediary form of physical, and then there's some part of us that is the soul, and then it goes off to some experience in an afterlife. I've never really been quite clear about the soul. But he says that unity gives us an all-embracing charity. What would an all-embracing charity be?
Abundance. Non-judgment.
Non-judgment.
Trust.
Trust. Wonderful. Nobody said a 501c3. Excellent. There is a compassion and a kindness, because I know people in the class have talked about compassion. We're on a spiritual path. We go to Center for Spiritual Living Asheville. We want to be able to have kindness and love and compassion and charity. So he said, just the fact of our oneness gives it to us. So we don't have to go to, I need to be more compassionate. I need to work on my compassion. I need to open up to more compassion. He says, no. There is a connection, this idea called oneness, where love is all there is, that automatically gives you an all-encompassing compassion or charity. That was the language of the day, a charity that you've already got. And he says that it, now take a deep breath, because this is going to be the point of discussion. He says that it allows you to look into the faces of the vilest, to look below all the scum or veneer of life, and find our brother and our sister. So he says that there's something in you right now, because of this idea called oneness, that has already given you an all-encompassing charity, that allows you to look right into the face of the vilest, the scum of life, and find our brother and our sister. And so, pop quiz, how are you doing with that? Because that's the part of being on the spiritual path. When we come to Center for Spiritual Living, we want to be moving along down the spiritual path, and a big thing of that is being able to tune into that charity, that compassion, that kindness, that love within us, that non-judgment, that abundance and prosperity, which means we have more than enough of whatever it is we need, and to be able to see it even in the faces of those that we would label vile and scum. So really, this is not a rhetorical question. I think it's an important conversation. How are you doing with that?
It's tough.
But how are you doing with it?
I'm doing okay when I wrap my brain around this oneness that he's referring to. I refer to as the mighty I Am presence that's in everything and every person, and that is one soul. When I look at the individual personalities that are vile and violent, no. I have a big problem with it until I put myself into the I Am presence is still in them. And they're just expressing the
And
shadow.
Then can you see it?
Yes.
Good. Good. Some would call that enlightened, Nicholas.
For a second, I could see it.
A second. A moment. Michelle.
I'm always fascinated when I see people, maybe you see it on TV, where they're sitting in front of someone who's murdered a family member, or, and, you know, they are able to forgive them or even sit there. I recently saw where the father had charged at the molester of his daughter, and I felt this, like, I think I would probably do that. You know, like maybe I wouldn't, but there's this part of me that's like, would I be able to see that person and not feel angry and, you know, not look at them and think you're a murderer or you're a molester or, you know, pass that judgment.
Those are pivotal points in life. Yeah. David.
I've had that experience with my daughter-in-law, with my son's girlfriend. I mean, she attacked us all the time, verbally, mentally, called us devil worshippers, and constantly throwing black magic up on our backs. And I basically was able to transmute and transcend without getting angry with her at all.
Oh, good.
I was able to love her through it. She was bipolar, I found out later on, which was something that she needed a deep-seated compassion for. But I thought she was on drugs. I didn't know what she was on, but she was just on her high. And so me and Shirley experienced this through years. So we're letting go now of all that. We have gradually, she destroyed two $800 phones. She would constantly interrupt him.
Be careful of your attachment to the story.
Yeah, the work and all that was. But you know what? Even when the work... When he was not there, I was able to just step right over him and just do what I needed to do to take care of things.
Good.
I wasn't caught up in the, and the anger would come in. You know, I'd want to kill for a second, and then I'd go back to, oh, no, I can't take that. You know, and even when she'd do all these things, she knew I was, she could tell I was angry at her. So I had to not be angry. I had to just basically totally detach and stay away as much as possible, you know, and
so that's half
focus
the journey.
On the way I wanted to behave.
Half the journey,
peaceful.
A really good half, a really important half. He's saying to take the next step to be able to see her as a brother or a sister.
I have.
Have you? Because you're shaking your head no.
Well, okay, maybe I haven't, but, you know, I think I don't think I'm holding any resentment.
Good. Can you love her?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay. Good.
Yeah,
good. That's the rest of it. Not holding any resentment.
She's probably one of the greatest gifts I ever had.
Not wanting to kill her.
She deflated my ego.
Okay.
I had to use spirit.
Yeah.
I had to. Or I would have just self-destructed.
Right. Good for you.
Yeah.
So you went from wanting to kill her to being able to love her.
Yes.
Big steps, David. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yay.
It was
yay. Nobody says that you don't go through that first step of it's hard.
Yeah.
I have a lot of anger. Boy, I could do that. But then we continue on until we get on the other side. Put your hand up. Linda.
I think that was the greatest message in the shack was until you walk in their shoes, you can't judge. Because, you know, when the person playing God was saying, why can I not destroy this one of my creations? I know where they came from and what caused them to be who they are.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't see them the same way because of that.
Right. Walk a mile in my moccasins, Native American proverb. Was anybody tuned in when South Africa came out of apartheid?
Mm-hmm.
And they had the trials?
Oh, yeah.
The trials were not for the purpose of putting people in jail. They were for the purpose of reconciliation. And they would have the parents or the families of the person who had been killed or maimed come together with the person who had done that, and they would speak their piece to get over the anger and the upset and to be able to move to love, because Nelson Mandela, who had spent all those years in prison in hard labor, understood that if they carried their hatred forward, it would destroy their country. And so they had to find a way through their hatred. And anybody in their right mind would say, well, they had a right to be full of hate. They had a right to want to kill all of those people, but it would not have helped. The difference between Haiti and the Dominican Republic, two halves of the same island. When the Dominican Republic revolted and came into ownership of their country, the black plantation workers rose up and took their country back. They took their country and included the white plantation owners. When Haiti rose up, they killed all of the white plantation owners. And the difference in the two countries is staggering. The Dominican Republic has a healthy economy. Their people have food. They have an excellent educational system, and they are a strong country. Haiti is still trying to come out of it. You can't harbor hatred and expect to live the life you want to live. It's not going to happen. You have to find that charity, that compassion inside of you. And nobody said it's going to be easy, but if what you want is on the other side of that door, and to walk through it, you cannot hate. It's just you cannot hold on to this idea that says, oh, you're vile and disgusting. Oh, I would never do that. What a lie that is. Of course we would do that. Given the circumstance, the history, the situation, we would do it all. So you can't say, you are this awful person, and I'm just, oh, my good, holy, and spiritual. No, because until you can see the presence of the divine in that person, you're not good and holy and spiritual. You're just judgmental and vindictive. That doesn't give us what we want. So check yourself out. I mean, really, this is an important thing. Jane, you're just about to bust over there.
Well, there's a lot of stuff going on.
There always is.
So what's the best thing? I mean, I have in my life people that I really I haven't found my heart in my heart to forgive. So the best I can do is turn my back.
That's a step. But eventually you're going to have to love them. Eventually you're going to have to find a place to not hate them. But turning your back is a good halfway measure.
It is
good. That's way better than wanting to kill them.
Yeah, detach.
Detaching is a great first step, but in order to get what you really want, you're going to have to find a way to love them. And you may start just by saying, I love you, I forgive you, I love you, I forgive you, I love you, I forgive you. I'm not a big fan of forgiveness because I think it's a halfway measure. You have to have something to forgive. I would like to jump all the way to the other end that says, thank you. Thank you for your gift because it helped me, whatever, find my strength. It helped me understand who I am. It helped me grow. It helped me, whatever. Thank you for your gift, because I have this idea that says before we are born, we get together with our peeps. And we say, I want to learn power. I want to learn self-reliance. I want to learn love. Will you help me? And that person says, you betcha. And we jump into physical form, and then they show up as someone who is the perpetrator to our victim. And on a higher level, there is a great gift in that. And if you can get the gift in that, You don't need to do the forgiveness stuff because there's nothing to forgive. There's only gratitude. There's only taking the blessing out of it and moving into a greater experience of life. If you're still telling the story and then saying, I forgive you, that's not really the best thing, but it's way better than if you're telling the story and saying, I just want to kill them or get them. You know, I just want to hurt them. That's a very dangerous place to be.
With me, I just prefer to turn my back on them as so they don't exist.
Well, but they do exist.
Yeah, but in another state.
But they exist in your heart because there's hurt.
Yeah,
so what I'm giving you is an opportunity to get the blessing out of it, to be grateful, and to move on without the encumbrance of the hurt. And I understand, like Nicholas said, sometimes it's hard. But I think you've been carrying this around for a long time.
Since I was born.
Right, so it might be okay to let it go.
Well, yeah. Well, I mean, the best way to let it go is to turn your back on it.
That's the beginning, but turning your back on it is only half of it. You have to turn to something else. You can't just have an empty spot. I'm not going to be mad. I'm not going to be mad. I'm not going to see a pink elephant. I'm not going to see a pink
getting
elephant.
Their
I'm
approval,
not going to see
getting
a pink
their
elephant.
Approval doesn't
and then all you do is see the pink elephant. You've got to turn toward something else. So turn toward I love you.
But saying it silently, not to them. I mean, you can be cool around someone. I try to ignore her like she turns her back on.
Look at that
I'm not going to indulge in trying to get that person's approval.
Well, of course not. I'm not asking you
to get
their
approval.
Approval.
I don't need their opinion for anything. All I do is I just try to get through whatever situation I'm in and move on in a peaceful, professional way.
Right.
That's the way I do
and
it.
And somewhere in your heart, you're going to have to find the space to see your brother or your sister as them. Because as long as you're still angry with them, I don't need their approval, I don't need their opinion, then you're hooked.
Okay.
Rocking Bear used to say, if they can make you angry or afraid, they own you.
They do both.
Yeah, wow. And I don't want to be owned.
It's giving your power away.
It's giving your power away. I don't want to be owned. And I know it's asking a lot, you know, but Fenwick starts right off with it. To see the vile and the scum, to be able to find your brother or your sister, I would say to find yourself in there, to find the light in there, to find the love in there. It's our job as spiritual beings. I live in a world created by love. Well, are you seeing the love everywhere? Sometimes it shows up in disguise. Doesn't matter, it's our job to see it.
See it,
Nicholas.
I could see that the silver lining is when I do forgive and see the light in them, the power is restored to me because of the love.
Exactly. If you want what you want, it's on the other side of seeing the God in them. And what is it that holds us back? People say, I don't have enough money, I don't have enough time, my body is, you know, is doing things I don't want it to do. Well, who are you still upset with? Because that has held your good hostage. And we are so willing to sell ourselves out for our position of being right. Well, they did me wrong. So of course I get to be upset with them. And we're willing for that ego charge of it, of being right, to sell out the good for the rest of our lives. And I guarantee you it's not worth it. That person is not worth it. So you might as well go ahead and love them.
Well, I love them. I mean, I prefer just to, they live somewhere else.
I love it when they're not around.
Troy.
I had an experience with my father, and we were estranged, and he died suddenly, and it's been, I don't know, maybe 15 years since he passed. During that 15 years, I held on to my hate, thinking that that was justified. I felt that I was in the right. That type of thinking might sound good, but or might sound good initially, but when you realize that you've held that for 15 years, if you would have examined it closer and tried to take that person and break him down or her down and understand that they followed the path that one step at a time, just like we do, and they did what they did with little consideration or little thought, but just following their natural instincts. They wouldn't have, or they couldn't have, done anything else because they didn't do anything.
Right. You're quoting me. They did what they did. If they could have done anything different, they would have. Since they didn't, they couldn't.
So 15 years later, what I got out of it was, I wish I could have found it in me to do it at an earlier time instead of holding on to my ego.
Which would have freed up all kinds of creative energy inside of you.
Yes. Yes.
It's difficult to love someone like Betty and hate someone else. It constricts our love instead of having all of our love to give. For you.
Yeah.
Judith.
One thing I've learned here is that, and one thing where I've come to is that once I forgave myself, I was able to forgive other people in my life that I had anger towards. I was able to relax. And
right,
just,
because it's usually projection.
Exactly, and it was just what you're talking about. But you know, that conversation I told you I had with my mother, she said, I hope you can forgive me. I said, I do forgive you. I hope you can do forgive me. Because I saw my own part in it. And you know, not everybody gets to see their own part in it. But
right.
I choose to see my part.
Not everybody chooses to see their own part in it.
Right.
Everybody gets to.
Right.
Yes, yes. Yeah, so I always like to bring it back to me. Whenever anything is going on, I check myself out. Where is that inside of me? Get somewhere where I can breathe, get my head screwed on straight, and then move on in life. And it's amazing to me how people change.
When we change.
Exactly. When I change, it's amazing how people change. Drew.
Forgiveness has nothing to do with any of that.
No, of course not.
Inside, you know.
If I were to tell my story, people would, and they have, said, why aren't these people in jail? Oh my God, that's horrible. How could they do that to an animal, let alone a child? And all this. I mean, people would be aghast, and some would weep. And like I said many times, I could write books on many things that happened in my life. And more. But the heinous things that happened that were just beyond the pale. I was poisoned, drugged with a car. So, I mean, I'm just on and on and on. These things, if I can't see God in everyone's eyes, and I can't forgive them. If I'm not in that place to be able to forgive them, I can't move. I'm stuck. I'm stuck holding.
Exactly.
I've got my hand is in the monkey jar. You know, and it's like, oh, what am I doing wrong? What am I doing wrong?
So what I see is that you bit off a lot in this life,
Drew.
Not only that, you went from your childhood to being a commando. So you bit off a lot, and right now you are reaping the harvest of that. Because your heart is wide open.
Letting go of that, you know, because that's a little tiny morsel. You know, it's like, but the monkey won't let go. The monkey.
But you're not a monkey.
That idea. Putting their hand in the jar and grabbing something and not being able to pull it back.
Right.
You got to let go. So
right.
But it's that work with you. It's like Judith said, you know, forgiving yourself, that is the first step. Yeah, and then working on to forgive others. You don't have to, you know, run back in time or call them on the phone or meet up with them for coffee and I totally agree. No. It's an inside job.
Right, because there's nothing to forgive.
Yeah.
That's where I want people to get to. You can do forgiveness work and you can do 70 times 7 and all of that to get you to the point where you realize there's nothing to forgive.
Nothing to heal either, right?
Nothing to heal. Only truth to be revealed. And what is the truth that you are revealing, David?
Oh, unconditional love.
There you go.
Yeah.
Once you feel unconditional love for her,
yes,
she will change, she will leave, your life will totally shift.
I really do. I've gotten, I may be a work in progress with that.
You are.
But I really...
We all are.
If it wasn't for this teaching, I would be lost.
Your prosperity is being held by that person. You gonna let her keep it?
No.
Love the hell out of her.
Yes.
Love
okay.
the hell out
Thank
of her.
You.
I
oh,
practiced
no.
that for years here.
Okay.
And people will either change or they will leave. Just love the hell right out of them. Drew.
I used to say when I first came here I was broken and all this other stuff. But I wasn't broken. There was no fixing. I just felt that way.
Right, but now you don't feel that way anymore.
I feel amazing. I feel surrounded by my peeps. I mean, I'm just
yeah.
up on high on the mountain. And I'm
there
waiting.
You go.
I'm ready for the next awesomenesses, you know. I wake up every morning looking forward to the day.
Good.
Coffee.
Good, 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 good.
After
good.
Don't forget
anybody else before we move on from this. This idea about being able to see our brother or our sister in the vial and the scum is all about oneness. Remember, he's talking about oneness, and he's saying that that oneness is what gives us that sense of love that is charity, that great sense of charity. He also talks about things that happen when you don't feel that connection. And he says that when you don't feel that connection, when you feel separation, that you're not feeling connected with everybody, love isn't the only reality, you're not able to let go and move on into that greater sense of self. He says that's when you get sick. And that's when what people call evil shows up in the world. It's a sense of separation. It doesn't have inherent truth to it, doesn't have inherent persistence to it, although some people would believe that evil, quote unquote, is a given. You know, how people can think in the anthropomorphic Judeo-Christian mindset, the paradigm that they use, the metaphor that they use, that the devil could be equal to God when the devil was one of the angels under God, and that God threw the devil out of heaven. How then does that disenfranchised entity called devil combat with full force that which God is? I mean, even in that story, it's ridiculous. But people have this idea that there is an evil, that there is an evil in people, that there is an evil in places, that there is an evil in life, that the devil made me do it, that the devil can get me. It's all a crock. What appears to be that is a sense of separation. And as soon as we move into love, as soon as we move into there's forgiveness, and then there's nothing to forgive, there's only gratitude, because there's only love, then all of those things dissipate. So, if you're feeling like there's, and we won't say evil because we don't use that word very much here, badness, wrongness in the world, consider that you're feeling a sense of separation, and that if you move into this idea of oneness, it will go away. Walk a mile in my shoes. Understand where I've come from. When I worked with an organization called Results, which was a grassroots political lobbying organization designed to reduce infant mortality rates, which at that time were 40,000 a day worldwide. Yes, that was 40,000 a day. Raise female literacy rates and boost immunizations. I know there's a push against immunizations, but in developing countries, it's a really good idea to have those things. They would coach people and say, before you go to your congressman or senator's office or legislature's office and meet with them, understand that they in their hearts are trying to do good in the world. They are in their hearts trying to do good in the world, and meet them on those terms, and then invite them into what you're presenting as a better way to do it. And I thought, boy, that works for everybody in the world. Everybody in the world is trying to be a good person. They're trying to do good. They're trying to live a good life. Nobody wakes up in the morning, well, very few, and then you've got to walk a mile in their shoes to see what happened to make them crazy. But very few people wake up and just say, well, how many people can I kill today and hurt and torture and maim? Most people really have a desire to live a better life, and if you can see that in them and meet that in them and invite them into a better way, let's not fight, let's work on this together, let's both love Jesse together, you know, your common bond is you both love Jesse, then you can bring them in to a bigger experience. He drew a circle to shut me out, a thing to flaunt, a thing to flout. But love and I had the wit to win. We drew a bigger circle and took him in. Yeah. Let's take a break. I love this next chapter because it's all about feelings.
As the alien songs go after that.
But before he gets into that, he's going to lay some basic premises out. I want you to stay with me during this. Everything and beyond is mind. So everything, every bit of form, which includes time because it's a space-time continuum in this universe layer, and beyond is mind. So we talked about that when we talked about the difference between pantheism and panentheism. I just laughed when I saw John's talk. It's like, were you in my Monday night class? Because we just went through all of that. So everything and more is mind.
Are you saying mind or mind?
Mind, but that's brain, so it's mind. Everything originates in mind. Everything is a thought. Every idea comes together in form. So every form comes from an idea or a thought. Everything, things originate in mind. And that's wonderful because if something is in your life, something is in your life, it came from an idea or a thought. If you want to shift it, where do you work?
In mind,
in ideas, in thoughts. That's where you make the shift because that's where everything comes from unformed substance, from this thought acting upon universal mind and creating into form. So you go back to thought or mind. All form is idea. So everything that is in physical form is idea. It's an idea. It comes from an idea, either at a relative level, at the level of us, or an absolute level, at the level of spirit. It's an idea. All substance is mental. So no matter what it looks like, there is a mental cause, there is a thought, there is an idea that generates that form, that thing, that substance. Okay, those are the basic premises to get into the chapter. Is everybody on the same page?
Okay.
Anybody saying no, that's crazy talk?
Is this chapter 5?
No, this is chapter 8. This is going to be your reading this coming week.
Oh, okay.
You are reading 7 and 8 this week. But I want you to feel smart when you read it, and I'm only touching on certain things, so next week I'll ask you if you've got questions or comments on your reading, and we can fill in the spaces. Steve?
How do you differentiate between mind and brain?
Oh, the brain is a physical organ. The mind is the person who just, the being, the energy, that just asked that thought. Who is that? It's beyond your brain, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. The brain is simply an organ or a tool of intelligence or mind. People get confused. They think their mind is their brain. There is a thinker behind the thought. Somebody decided to think that thought. And that's an easy way to just start to get a sense of it. If the brain could think, when you take it out of a body, it could continue to think. And it doesn't. It just rots. Pardon?
Recently I had somebody propose to me that our mind is in our aura. It is outside of our body.
Yeah.
It is in our aura.
Yeah.
That's a really interesting concept I've never heard of. I've been chewing on that one recently. I've been concerned about thinking it's more in ourselves. Because, like, if you...
It's everywhere.
Yeah.
It's in your aura. It's in your cells. It's everywhere. In this idea of oneness, it has to be everywhere. It is not physical, so it is not in a place. It is beyond physicality. It is energy, so it has to be everywhere.
It has to be everywhere.
Yeah, David.
Yeah, read supply every morning.
Yes.
Earnest. And Earnest says substance is supply. God,
yes.
God is substance. Substance is supply.
Right.
Not just mental.
Therefore, God is supply.
That's a keynote to a newer realization of a more abundant life.
Good.
The demonstration of success in financial matters. I pretty much got the whole thing memorized.
What page is it?
It's on page 226.
Page 226 in the revised?
262.
262.
I just open it to that.
Page 262.
My preamble.
Page 262 in the revised Science of Mind textbook, which is what most of the world uses as the Science of Mind textbook. We use both of them, the original and the revised, but this is 262 in the Science of Mind textbook. It is on supply. It is a wonderful essay. And David reads it every morning. He doesn't know what page it's on, but
right,
he probably hasn't
marked. I don't know if I'm really... I read it every day, no matter what.
Good.
So
good,
God
good.
Is substance, and substance is supply? Is that...
Ask David.
263, yeah.
264.
Earnest is supply. It's on.
God is supply, and God is substance, and substance is supply. It is the unformed substance from which everything comes. Yeah.
And he says it's mental.
It is.
God.
Yes. Okay.
It's all one.
Yes, it is.
Okay.
And then the next idea is love itself is the unified consciousness. There is a unified consciousness that is love. There's only love. I live in a world created by love. Love is what I am. There's only love. Love is it, baby. There is a consciousness, and everything is one. So saying it's unified is just a different way of saying what we've been saying over and over again. And what he's saying is that it's love, it's mental, it's love, it's intelligence, it's wisdom, it's health, it's prosperity, it's wholeness, all of these words. But for where he's going here with feelings, it's love. Got it?
Got it.
Okay.
I love it.
So whatever God is, spirit, makes manifest all of manifestation as one. That's why we can say that the table and the chair are all part of the oneness. Because whatever spirit is, spirit manifests out of itself. It's all one. So even the manifest universe is the oneness. Because people want to get into separation so bad. Well, spirit is all that there is, but for God's sake, not a plastic table. That's just wrong. You can't recycle that or compost that. That's going in the landfill. It's wrong. It's bad. No. It's one. It's spirit. It's God.
Can you repeat the sentence again that you said for that?
No. Okay. I don't know what I said.
But you had said something.
I'm just winging it here.
You went on to explain and then I lost what you said.
Spirit making it, creating out of itself. Spirit as one. The infinite wisdom and intelligence and creative force of all of life creates out of itself, becoming that which it creates. These are basic ideas of Science of Mind Therefore, the oneness of spirit is made manifest as still the oneness, even though it looks like two-ness. That's the trick. That's what we got to watch out for, because we're in this space-time continuum, and it looks like there's here and there and now and then. It sure looks like that, but there is only here and now, and there is only one. So the oneness manifesting out of itself must still be the oneness, even though it looks like two-ness. Got that?
Yes.
These are some high metaphysical thoughts. So stay with me and ask questions if you're getting lost. There can be no place outside of mind. Whatever mind is infinite, so there can't be anything on the other side of it. You cannot have, remember, this is the circle without any circumference, and this is the space-time continuum. You cannot have a place, which is space, outside of mind. You cannot have a little space time continuum over here, because then you have an edge and you have spirit or mind, and then you have not. You cannot have a not. If you have a not of anything, then the infinite is no longer infinite, time and space no longer hang together, and nothing is here. So either everything is spirit and God, or we're not here. Your choice.
We're all just figments of our own imagination.
I don't even think we would have our own imagination, because spirit would not be infinite. Therefore, it could not exist in any realm at any level. So, no place outside of mind. Okay, those are the basics. I'm going to run through them again. Everything and beyond is mind. Everything originates in mind. All things are thought. All form is idea. All substance is mental. Love itself is the unified consciousness. God made manifest as one. No place outside of mind. You got that? Okay, here we go. Now he's going to talk about this feeling body that we have. The feeling body is not the physical body. So he's moving into outer realms and dimensions. He says that the feeling body can be seen as an aura. You just talked about Arden mind being like an aura, can be seen as an aura, only there's no limit to your aura. I mean, this was decades ago. They could measure people's auras from 30 feet away. And there's no point where the energy field around your physical body stops. It goes out forever. That's where we are connected, where we touch each other, everything that needs to be known, all of that is all at a level outside of our body. And Fenwick, 100 years ago, is trying to explain this to people that have never heard about it before. He's saying that the feeling body is the form in which the higher consciousness of the individual clothes itself. So he's inferring that the physical body is the lower consciousness, not in bad, not like higher consciousness is better. I would put it more in vibration, that the energy that allows us to hold on to physical form is dense. Has anybody had a near-death experience? What was it, dense or light?
Light.
Did it feel easy and free, or did it feel heavy and hard? Free. So he's saying that to hold our focus in time and space, it does take a bit of denseness and a lower vibration to hold this energy. Now he's saying that there are other, and Ernest says there are bodies within bodies within bodies to infinity. He's talking about one called the feeling body, and he's saying that you can see it. Some people can see it. You can measure it. And that it is the higher part of you. that is clothing itself. I love his languaging. It's clothing itself as this feeling body. He says the feeling body is affected by thoughts and actions of other people.
Do you think he's referring to the astral body that would...
I don't know what an astral body is.
Same thing, feeling body, emotional body, astral body, mental body, their levels.
I don't know. I don't know about that. So when he talks about love is the unified consciousness, and we have this energy that connects us to everything and everyone, what do you think that energy is?
It's an aura of light that comes out of us.
It's light and love. It is a higher vibration. It's going to be charity and compassion and a willingness to let go of the denseness. Have you ever been angry? How dense is that? That's not all light and airy-fairy and easy breezy. That is dense and heavy. And so he's saying that there's a body very much like your physical body, but it's not physical, and it's love, and it's a higher vibration. He's also giving us a word of caution that this feeling body can be affected by other people. Have you ever been affected by other people?
Some people are more sensitive, yes, too, to the people around them.
Some people are more sensitive to the people around them. Some people are just unconscious, and they allow themselves to be affected. They react, and they don't stop to think about it. I don't know why Robinson is on his mind, other than on my mind, other than 6 o'clock this morning, John's hawk wing that he uses for smudging for the firewalk fell off of a shelf way up on the wall and went whack right on the floor next to the bed. I was wide awake. What was that?
It was Rocking Bear.
Really? Really? So when someone would go and start either complaining or dissing or something like that, you'd go like this. You're trying to hook me. Trying to hook me. And most people are hookable. Most people don't even think twice. They see an event, they make a judgment about it, they react to it, and they're hooked. They're gone down the rabbit hole. You know, that's their whole story in their life now, and they don't realize they just missed riches and love and joy and success because they took all their energy and got hooked and went down the rabbit hole. So what you're learning to do is to stay in that higher vibration of love and light, excuse me, and have your life the way you want it. When it's around Christmas, I will often ask people to go to the mall, walk through the mall, and check yourself out and see if you picked anything up on the way. It may be that you're irritated, like, this is a stupid thing, I don't like the mall, I want to get out of here. Jeez, how much more do I have to walk? This is ridiculous. And then you leave the mall and you're all, rah, 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 rah. And to look at yourself and ask yourself, is that mine? Or did I pick it up along the way?
Yeah.
It's a good question to ask because your feeling body is affected by people, thoughts, and ideas around you. That's one reason I encourage you not to watch the news before you go to bed. If you're going to watch the news, watch it in the morning where you've got the whole day to work on yourself. To watch the news and go to sleep just gives it to your subconscious mind, and you've taken all of the drama and trauma and upset of life in a very select and focused presentation called news. And then you sleep on that. So check yourself out. Really, a good thing at the end of every day is to check yourself out and see if there's anything that you're holding on to or that is holding on to you that is not yours. You know, and you can get pretty elaborate with it. You can say, are there any entities that have latched on you, you know, and you need to cleanse that and release it. I don't think we have to get that dramatic. Just, is there anything that you've picked up that isn't yours? Sometimes, I heard a story about a couple, and the wife would make the husband go into this special room before he was allowed in the house with the family and clean himself up energetically, because he would bring all this stuff in from work and be all and she says, no, you sit in there until you're fit to be with your family. Let it go. Do whatever you need to do to shift your energy to be the person that we know you to be, that we love, and then come in. And he would do that every day. He would let it go, send it away, and then go and be with his family. So learn how to check yourself out. Does anybody do this? Does anybody check yourself out? Amanda does. Jane does. And then Michelle does. And then let it go. One of the things that I do if I'm seeing people in my office, and usually they're kind of stacked up, it'll be like a seeing people in my office day, I'll go and wash my hands. And it's symbolic of letting go of all that stuff that I've just been immersed in that is not mine and I don't want to keep it. Now, there are other times when you want to take from your surroundings. What situation might that be? You want a cough drop, Deb?
No, I am.
Okay. When might you want to let yourself be affected by people, feelings, and ideas around you? Susan?
I'm in consult with people all the time that are about to get married, and I even say out loud to them sometimes, I come home with all that love dust.
Right.
And just all, I mean, people feel the best, look the best, have the highest expectations. They're in love, and I got that all over me from them.
Wonderful. Being around people that are about to get married. When else might you want to put yourself in a situation where you are affected by the people around you?
Being here.
Being here. Thank you, Sandy. Linda.
Going to the maternity ward.
Do you go and hold the babies?
No, I don't, but that would be where that would be one place you could get all the goody feelings. Because I remember the nurses saying they fight over who gets to be around all this joy and happiness.
Right, you can hold the babies, but you have to go through training.
Yeah,
going to the maternity ward, just looking through the glass at the babies. Wow, Jane.
I have got a lot of stuff that seems to be going on right now, and I need to get rid of it. And I have a Qigong teacher. I mean, he teaches up at the Asheville Yoga Center.
So you go to Qigong?
Yeah.
Wonderful. It's smart move. Who else? Chuck.
Gardening, hands in the dirt.
Gardening, hands in the dirt. And how about walking a labyrinth? We have a labyrinth in the upper parking lot, for those of you who don't know, that Chuck has hand-painted, and four times a year he turns the sanctuary into this huge labyrinth.
Yeah.
They're like 30 by 30 feet. They're amazing. Mm-hmm. So walk a labyrinth. What else can you do? Judith?
Obviously, when I'm shooting in the mountains, sunrises, sunsets, being around other people who are creating at the same time.
Put yourself in nature. Be around like-minded people, people that are going or being where you want to go or be. Sounds pretty basic to me. Be careful of picking up crap from your surroundings that is not yours. Get rid of it, let it go, and intentionally put yourself in environments where you're going to be surrounded by positive, healthy, happy, prosperous, joy-filled people, and then take all that in. Open up to it. Betty.
I was just going to say that sometimes you need to do your inventory at the end of the day to see if you picked up anything from anybody else. You might want to check and see if there's something that you picked up from yourself that you don't want.
Sure. Anything that you don't want, you are in charge. You can let
it
go.
That's what I'm saying. It's not always everybody else. Sometimes it's something you picked up that you want to go over.
Well, from that internal critic inside of your head, but I think that person picked something up along the way too.
Yeah.
So the dominoes continue to fall. So he says that your physical body is charged with feeling consciousness. That feeling consciousness uses your physical body but is independent of it. So he's saying you have this, here's your physical body. Welcome to Barbara's stick figures. So I remember when they used to think that our consciousness was 18 inches above our third eye and that that's where the consciousness was. No. We have a body, but we are so much bigger than our body. We have a body, but we're not our body. We are this infinite being that has a little body in it. And we kind of drag this body around with us through this experience called life. And when the body is laid down, we're still there, just without the body. That's all that happens. So he's saying that you've got he's saying you've got like a feeling body around your physical body, and that your feeling body charges your physical body. Have you ever noticed that when you have a feeling, your physical body responds? Oh, baby, oh. Or your physical body responds. If you, in your emotions, in your feelings, have a charge on something, your body is going to respond. What kind of things might you have a charge on that your body would respond to?
Family of origin.
Family of origin. You could have feelings about your family of origin, which could be, oh, they're so wonderful, I'm so happy, I love my family so much, and your body responds to that. Or it could be, oh no, these dirty, rotten rack and fratchets, they have filed suit against me again, and your body responds to that. Okay, I thought you were putting your hand up, Mandy. He's saying that the feeling consciousness or the feeling body is between your conscious mind and your physical body. I don't know. I don't know if we have to get into specific placements. But he's saying if you want to really learn to demonstrate, this is something to get. You can learn to use your feeling body, which impacts physical form, whether it's your physical body or the body of your affairs. And if you are doing an affirmation or a treatment or setting an intention with no feeling to it, what's going to happen?
Nothing.
Nothing. Nada. Yet. It's not going to work. So you have to learn to generate the feelings that you want to live. Why do you think I make you say every day, today is a
happy day?
Because I want you to be happy. But if you go, check off. You're supposed to feel it. You're supposed to do the happy dance when something happens. You're supposed to look foolish. Go to April's class on play. I don't know. You want to commit your energy into it.
You can.
No, I'm good. Because if you have a thought and you can supercharge it with your feelings, stuff happens. So if someone says, oh, I have the flu, and I just coughed all over you, and I go, oh my God, they have the flu, oh, Priorel, go take a shower, oh no, I'm so afraid. What's gonna happen?
You're gonna get
the flu, even if they didn't have it. They just thought they had it. That's all it is anyways, a thought. So we have a saying in Science of Mind. It's a thought plus a feeling equals an action. So yes, you want to learn how to think. Change your thinking, change your life, but that's only part of it. Because if you think a thought and you have absolutely no feeling that is in alignment with that thought, it's not going to happen. I'm prosperous. Oh, gee, I hope that I can rub 2 cents together to go get on the bus. I'm abundant. Oh, gosh, they're coming to collect the rent. That's not going to work. To learn how to generate the feelings that you want to have is amazingly powerful. He says you've got a whole feeling body. And it goes between your conscious mind and your physical body, or the physical body of your affairs, to generate that feeling that says, yes, I have more than I ever dreamed possible. Yes, I am loved and perfect and whole and complete. Yes, I love my body. My body is healthy and flexible and young and strong. That's who I am. It's the words, but it's the feelings that come along with it. To put yourself in an environment where you get surrounded by people that say, yes, you can. You can. Anything is possible. We're dealing with miracles here. What do you want to have in your life? You can have that. You can be that. You can do that. To put yourself around that and then just say, bring it on, baby. Just suck it up. Changes your energy field. People can see the difference. Have you ever looked at somebody and go, what's wrong? Oh, nothing. Oh, yes, there is. You need to clean it up and shift it. You go in the bathroom and get your head screwed on straight.
Go
you
flush
do
it.
Something.
Go
no,
flush
wash it.
It
off, whatever it is. And you go up to someone else and go, wow, you're just beaming. What is that? What happened? And they say, everything is going my way. And they may not have demonstrated any of that yet, but what's going to happen? Everything's going to go their way. Absolutely.
You said you could extend that light as wide as you want, right? That
it is already extended. You do not have to do that.
I often go down the road and say I'm in a bubble of light because I'm fearful of traffic or getting into accidents. So I'll say I'm in a bubble of light and I'm safe and secure.
Good. That helps you feel safe.
But
right?
I can extend my light. I actually believe a light comes out of the top of my head. It extends out all over my town, and then I can extend it all over this whole United States.
It doesn't stop.
And then it goes all over the world.
And it doesn't stop.
Yes, it keeps going into space.
It's
never
infinite.
Stops.
It is infinite.
Eternal.
You are infinite, David Williams. You are infinite. There's no place where you stop.
And in like the cell, it breaks down forever, it goes one way forever, and
okay.
Into space forever.
Right. And when you get really big and really little, they look exactly the same.
It's always there.
Yeah, yeah. Good, 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 good. But whatever you need to do to get your feeling self, your feeling body, feeling what you want it to feel, please do that. If you've got to start doing the happy dance and pretending that things are going great, there's a blessing in here somewhere. Do not open mail when you're feeling fearful. Don't do it. Wait until you're feeling great, till everything's on top of it. Go talk to your friends and let them say, there's a blessing in that envelope. Only good can come from this. You're so powerful. Everything's going your way. You're prosperous and loved and joy-filled. And you go, yeah, that's the truth. Then you open the letter. Because your feeling body will address the manifestation and change what happens. So if you're going to do that, lift it up. Lift it up into joy and happiness. You know, we could teach this teaching and everybody just go off into a cabin somewhere, but you won't get the same experience. Something happens when we're together. That's why we have people do testimonials, because everybody goes, wow, that's fantastic. If they can do that, I can do that. And then their feeling body shifts, and so their manifestation shifts. You have a tool. Fenwick calls it a feeling body. He says it's a higher vibration, it's a different vibration. And you can't see it, some people can see it. And you want to learn to use it. Because when you combine a thought and a feeling, something happens. Something happens. So don't do your affirmations, treatments, reading, and just go, don't do that, because the demonstrations that you have will be more inclined to your feeling than your thought. Jake.
I had something like that on Sunday, mm-hmm. And I suddenly thought, well, my word was sunshine in the search circle. Sunshine, which I had was kind of depressed before that, so I said, and suddenly I felt so sunny and happy. However, I lost track of what I was doing.
Oh, but that's usual. Right?
That's usual. unusual
for you?
Well, no. I mean, generally, I'm very careful when I play the bowls, but I was so full of sunshine, I just started ringing the bowl, and suddenly I thought, oh my God, I shouldn't be ringing the bowl right at this time.
So your task is going to be able to stay focused, which I know you've been working on for years, to be able to stay focused and joyous at the same time.
Oh, yeah.
Without just jumping into joy.
Oh.
Although, if you've got to jump between joy and the bowls, go ahead and jump to joy. It'll be all right.
Well, I certainly did a huge vibration that drowned out.
Because you were joy-filled. Yes.
Well, I was thrilled about that until I realized that I shouldn't be playing it right then and there.
Oh, who cares?
You shouldn't shit all of yourself.
Yeah, don't shit on yourself. So
yeah, I got in real big trouble for saying that to the wrong person. So.
What'd you say?
No offense.
You have two choices in life. When you get around people or circumstances or newscasts or false stories on Facebook, you have choices to either get sucked in and to react to them. And let those outer experiences then determine your creations in your life. Or you can choose to say, I am not going to be affected by this, turn away from the condition. I am a choice. My life is wonderful. I am prosperous and healthy and happy and whole. I am in control of my state. I am joy. I am love. That is the only reality. This is my choice. And when you do that, you let go of whatever energies you have temporarily picked up, and you redirect yourself into the life that you want to live. You have that choice all the time. Think about your partners. You know your partners get into funks. Mine does. I know that you guys have that experience. The people that you work with, your family, somebody is just being cranky. And you can go, oh, how dare they mess up my vibes? You just created my experience, and now they come in and they're messing up my vibes. You know, don't you mess up my vibes, and now you are in the same state, right? You just jumped into the abyss.
Punishing them.
Or you can go, I'm a powerful, creative, spiritual being. Nobody can mess up my vibes. I'm in control of my state. I choose joy. I choose love. I choose prosperity. I choose health and wholeness. For that matter, I'm so clear about who I am, I'm just going to love the hell out of that person. And then they either find somewhere to go, or they rise up to match that energy. You are always at choice. I know people who give up their state and their creations and their freedom over a traffic light. I had a student in Miami, Wesley. That was 82, 92, 2002, 2012, 2018. That was 35 years ago. And because he was so out of control with his emotional state, and it was reflecting in his business, in his money, in his relationships, and he would come to me for help, I would make him drive during traffic from 4 to 6 every day up and down one of the major roads in South Miami called Bird Road. He would just drive back and forth. And his job was not to be mad. It was his only job. You are not allowed to get mad. You let people in front of you. You do not honk. You do not flip people off through the window. You do not yell. You smile. You drive in harmony with other people. You are generous. And it took him like a year, but it really changed him. A
lot of gas money.
Changed him he was paying way more than that for his upset. People don't know that they are in charge of their feelings. And what Fenwick is telling you in this chapter is that your feeling body is so important, you can't see it, but it's there. It goes between your conscious thought and your demonstration. It's a feeling. And when you get your feeling and your thoughts in alignment, you're going to have a demonstration. You're going to have an action. Most people get their feelings and their thoughts in alignment in a way they don't want to go. Oh, I knew that guy was a crook. Now I have a thought that they're a crook and I've been taken advantage of, and a feeling, and what's going to happen? I'm going to lose it all because of that. So you want to get the thoughts you want to experience and generate the feelings of that. I've had people leave this center over this teaching. I cannot control my feelings. They just happen. I go, no, you choose to feel what you're feeling. That was rational emotive therapy in the 60s. You always think a thought before you feel a feeling. So think the thought of the feeling you want to feel. You always choose how you're going to feel. Now, somebody may think very, very quickly that I have a right to this feeling. Anybody in their right mind would feel this way. Of course, this is what I'm going to feel. And so I get my adrenaline all pumped up. I go into fight or flight. And then I run across the courtroom and jump the guy, you know, or whatever it is. That does not have to be your life. Being on the spiritual path means to be spiritual along the path. To do that, you have to stop acting like a jerk, even if it's only for a moment, and start acting from a higher level, and you will find that your demonstrations are just delightful, because love brings in money, joy brings in success. It's amazing. And we throw it away so quickly because we think that that feeling is a good idea. And I want to remind you, only feelings of love and joy, of charity. I'm trying to think of that word, it's an old word. Charity and compassion and kindness and generosity. Those feelings give you what you want. And it doesn't make you a doormat. Doesn't let people or things take advantage of you. For that matter, it has you cooking and vibrating at such a level that you are attracting way better things in than you even thought you were going to create. Nicholas.
What if someone is having the thought that their feelings are not safe? Maybe they're coming from the social mask of appropriateness, always wearing a...
Are you talking about yourself?
No.
Okay, then I don't want to talk about a fictitious person. Someone.
Well, when I'm angry, I don't feel safe. So I can talk about myself when I get to that level. But if there's a safety of that feelings aren't safe, would that change?
On a psychological level, I would encourage you to go get a tennis racket and a pillow and hit it and scream no and get some of that anger out. Mm-hmm. On a spiritual level, I would say that there is no anger, there's nothing to be angry at, there's only love and only joy. And if you can bypass the anger and jump to that, great. If you've got to go through the anger, then beat a pillow to death and scream no and get your anger out and realize that nobody died. So usually, on a psychological level, we usually don't let our anger out because we're afraid that there is so much rage inside of us. That if we let it out against a little bit, we're going to get a chainsaw and go around and kill people because we're so angry. So we use that as an excuse to stuff the emotion down. And if we let it out, we realize nobody died, nothing happened. I just screamed and got red in the face and beat this poor pillow to death. But it's okay. And then you can get more comfortable with your feelings. The problem with being comfortable with those kinds of feelings is that then people think, well, oh, that's my feeling. I'm in touch with my anger. I'm going to go through life angry. No, it was but a small stepping stone to a big space of love. That's where you want to go. And you get to the point where there's nothing to be angry at. There's only gratitude, and there's only love. Okay? Anybody else before we close? Good class. I love this. You know, this is the best class ever.
The best teacher.
And you're the best teacher.
Thank you, thank you. I'm a reflection of you, Andy. Take out what you're going to give. those of you watching online, no matter where it is in time or space, you too can be a part of this flow by going to the donate button on our website. If you're on YouTube, go to our website, cslasheville.org. The donate button is both at the top and the bottom of every page. Thank you. What I know is that God is the source of all supply, that we are blessed. I know that we are held and loved in this infinite mind of love, of spirit, of all that is. The infinite potential of all of life is what we are right now. And so the infinite love of the universe is what we are. The infinite prosperity of all that is what we are right now. And so as we give our gift tonight, we know that we are coming from a place of boundless abundance. We have more and more and more and more. Whether it's money or time or friends or opportunity, we always have more. And we give from that fullness. And we give to this Center for Spiritual Living Asheville, knowing that somehow we come together to make this center all that it is. It is a place of peace, a beacon of light, a tower of strength, and a fountain of wisdom that touches the lives of all who call it home. And so it is. Just breathe it in. We live and move and have our being in an expanding concept of energy, of creativity, of love, of intelligence, of joy. It is our nature. It is our essence. It is all that we are. We open up to that truth of who we are, knowing that our lives manifest that in every area. And I know that everything in these baskets is blessed because that which we are goes with our gift. I see it as light, golden light, pouring forth from each of us, filling up this room from the floor to the ceiling and all between the walls. This air is rich and blessed with spirit as us. And as spirit moves in our lives, things happen. So right here and right now, we are all touched, we are all blessed, and we are all healed. Yes, I know that energy cannot be locked up in a room, so it goes on around this world to touch and bless and heal every being on this planet, shooting out into the heavens, continuing to touch and bless and heal, to bring into alignment, to raise in vibration things that are beyond even my ability to comprehend. I know that energy is always here and always now, touching every one of us here tonight. Everyone who has ever been here, and everyone yet to come. And so it is. Thank you. Thank you for helping clean up the kitchen. Thank you, thank you, thank you.